Faisal, you mentioned the logos, and I know the name of your school is Diamond Logos. And I'm curious why you named it that and why that's important to you.
Yes. In my journey, again, you know, in this lifetime, I ran into not only the spiritual knowledge that I got some, you know, from direct experience and some from learning here and there, and so much waiting to learn, but also and of course the ordinary knowledges of, you know, sciences and all of that, that are immense what we have, you know, and could visit, you know, the universities to see how much knowledges there are. I also ran into a stream, a knowledge that is so fascinating, you know, is just incredibly mind-opening to a potential that could be sheer hallucination, fascination, or sheer magic beyond any magic, you know, beyond really any magic. And it's about a particular knowledge that they say it's been hidden from humanity. It's been sealed from humanity, sealed in different books and preserved by different lineages. You know, in fact, I know only one lineage that claims to have this knowledge, the Shinto priests, you know, the Shinto in Japan, you know. But some of this knowledge exists in Sufism and Christianity and Buddhism. And this knowledge refers to the logos. And in Christianity, you know, the logos is a huge thing. You know, it's an incredible integral part of Christ and the revelation. And this knowledge of the logos seems to contain within it the potential of all knowledges. All the knowledges that we have, if you can imagine that there is a mother tree and from it come so many branches, and each branch is one knowledge, one stream. Spirituality is one branch. The Diamond Logos was only one little branch in that big branch. You know, and science is another branch, and literature is another branch. But all of those contained within a grand container. And this grand container is the logos. What does that mean? What is the logos? You know, Shakespeare says, what's in a word? You know, and a friend of mine said, what's in a letter? What is in an alphabet? What is in an A? What is in a B? Where does A come from? Where does B come from? And where does this combinations of letters, you know, come from that make us think and know and perceive reality in a certain way as human beings and have names for it and knowledges from it? Fascinating. It's really fascinating inquiry. I remember that long time ago, in 77, 70, when I was in the midst of that great opening and exaltation of being in the absolute and luminosity, I remember came at a time certain guidance, you know, saying, why don't you use mantra, you know? Chant mantra, but chant it in the field. When you are in that state of openness, chant a mantra, you know? And the guidance was even more specific, said, not a whole mantra, but choose one word, like Sufis choose, they call it zikr or dhikr, you know? Mm-hmm. You say salam, you know, salam means peace. Ya salam, you know, whatever. Said, why don't you just chant it, you know, in the field? And it was in correspondence with sometimes I get a feeling I want to call upon something, you know. And the guidance says, we'll call upon what your heart desire. Love, call upon love, but make it a mantra, you know. So I would say love, 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 a whole week. And I go to the absolute and invoke love, or invoke beauty, or invoke majesty, or peace. And I notice that if I maintain the invocation for a certain period of time, usually a week, while I am still in the absolute, as if all of my system, molecular, structurally, mentally, psychically, I enter that state. Yeah. As I think Greg Braden mentions it about that, it takes about 72 hours, if you chant a mantra or a word, if you chant that, it takes 72 hours for the body to transform it into frequency in the physical plane. Yeah. So this, I said, oh, fascinating. The absolute is mind. That's what they say. It's the true nature of mind, Buddha mind, enlightened mind, the mind of God, you know, all of those things. And the word seemed to activate it. The logos seems to activate it. And if I keep chanting it, it'll transform my mind, you know, into the frequency of that quality. But it's not only going to transform my mind, it transforms my emotions too. I feel peace. And it transforms my body. I feel peace. And not only that, it downloads the quality of what peace is. What is peace? I look at what is peace that I see from this ocean of absolute, descend this black light. Majestic, beautiful black light. And as the black light descends, I feel my mind stops thinking so much. No worries, no anxieties, you know. And I really feel peaceful in my mind. And it descends in my heart. And all my attachment to my emotionality, you know, being four in the Enneagram, goes away, you know, to a total bankruptcy. And my heart is peaceful. Very peaceful heart. I don't know what to do with it, you know. I'm used to some kind of intensity. Then it descends into my belly and into the arms and legs. And in time, I felt like after a week, all my body feel peace. I feel fascinated, really fascinated by this experience. So I remember for 2 years, I kept playing with the names. You know, I call whatever I feel like, I call that state. But I do first the meditation. Meditation is like, you know, cleaning your, you know, taking a shower, washing everything, and then your clean slate, blackboard is clean, then you invoke, and the quality, the name begin to create frequency from the field. And the combinations of the letters, it's like hapsicon, produces effect, produces colors and lights. And we as an instrument, me as an instrument, translate it in what we know as human feelings. You know, maybe a cat might feel it this way. Maybe a tree might feel it differently as something different, you know, frequency. But it was so fascinating at that time that the word, that what I am saying, affect the enlightened field and transform it into a state. Then I just left it. It didn't seem to be like my kind of thing because I was interested in psychology and body and energy and essential state and colors and light, you know. But I wasn't interested in how does the word affect the absolute and generate a state, you know. Little by little, another friend of mine took on this task and started studying it, you know. And little by little, I remember in 76, I ran, not 76, is it 76? Yeah, 76. I ran into a book in which it talks about there is a hidden knowledge, that the knowledge is called the knowledge of enlightenment. And it's not what spiritual enlightenment talk about. It is about something totally different. And that knowledge of enlightenment was available to humanity, but humanity decided to hide it and fall from that knowledge of enlightenment. in order to go through certain evolution, and through the fall from that enlightened knowledge, we manage through great suffering to cultivate the material world. We fell from the enlightenment, we became scared, we became survivalists, terrorism started, and from terrorism we developed weapons, and from weapons came technology, and now we have mastered the material world. So the mission that humanity took on, to fall from the enlightened field and cultivate the material realm 6,000 years ago, this mission has been accomplished now. We did the job with a huge sacrifice. Brother killing brother because of distortions. We lost the knowledge of enlightenment. So this knowledge of enlightenment, they say, was preserved by the Shinto priests. The Shinto priests kept it hidden from one generation to another, and they give it to the Emperor of Japan, and the Emperor of Japan was considered to be God because he is the holder of this knowledge. So this knowledge was entrusted to a high being, and that high being has this knowledge represented by the Emperor, and this high being will come at a certain time again. You know, Christianity believe it's the second coming of Christ or the Mahdi in Islam. The Japanese have the same high being who's going to come with the elders and will open this knowledge to us. What is this knowledge? They said that this knowledge is about the, what are the alphabets? What are the letters? What does A do? And they start, you know, the Shinto priests. This man wrote a book called Koto Tama, in which he reveals this knowledge, that they revealed it to him. And the Shinto priests claim that we are the creators. We create through our speech, through our intentions and thoughts and intentionality. We create creation. And we create our states of mind and our psyche and our physical universe. And as the Aborigines in Australia said, that our ancestors sang the world, sang the earth, and it became this beautiful manifestation. So there is a knowledge that the speech is the power, is the mechanism of creation. And man speaks, vibrates the absolute, and the absolute come back with a manifestation of those words. So somehow, some time ago, we invented sound. And maybe that was the beginning of Big Bang. We were entities existing pre-time, pre-space, and this infinite source of potentiality. And somehow we managed to create alphabets. And each alphabet vibrated the absolute with a frequency, with color, with light. And the Shinto priests call it gods. So they say there are 54 letters, and these are the 54 gods, you know. And the interwovenness between those letters makes words, and make words make objects, you know. So maybe 100,000 or 100 million years ago, we said tree, T-R-E-E. And tree vibrated the absolute one way, R another way, E-E another way, and the result is an object that we see and perpetuate itself. It has a three-dimensionality of time, of a space, and time, four, and essence, five-dimensionality. You know? So the absolute can be vibrated by letters. And this is the knowledge of the Logos that's hidden. And this is what I pray for, that I am around with this when this knowledge will be revealed, and when the owner of this knowledge, you know, revealed to us this most magical, you know, that we created chemistry and physics through letters and words from the absolute. But we don't see that every second we are creating Big Bang. At this moment that I am talking, I'm creating Big Bang in the universe. My words exploding as a star or as a galaxy and comes back as a sound and as a phenomena. So this is fascinating for me. You know, it feels like, well, is there such a knowledge? You know? I've seen its effect. The ancient ones, the masters of the ancient ones say the universe is not light based but sound based. So I pray this knowledge will be revealed, because I think it will answer all those approaches. Now people are approaching it differently, you know, scientists saying this and philosophers saying that and spiritualists saying this, and to me they are all touching on the elephant in the dark, and each one is describing one piece of the elephant, you know. And if we see this language, we will really see the elephant, you know. And they say it'll, when this knowledge is initiated and discovered, it will take us about 1,000 years to gather the knowledge inherent in the Logos. So this is my fascination with the Logos. And I took one frequency and made it Diamond Logos, because we can articulate those states and spirituality in a way that is, I mean, fascinating, but not too scary, not too crazy. Little, but not too much. But it's all scientific. To me, it's all scientific.